In the previous video, we mentioned lists and maps, and how we have functions which allow us to manipulate them, but we haven't actually talked about what they are before, and so in this video we're going to talk about what they are, as well as looking at loops which are primarily relevant to lists and maps, although they can be used for other things too. So to begin, a list is essentially an array, if you're familiar with the term from more heavyweight programming languages. Or if not, they are a collection of values all assigned to one variable. So where a normal variable might only have one value assigned to it, a list can have many. Let's take a look at a list then. We mentioned earlier that the container and elements we focused on early on, and we mentioned that we could also have a blog page and a news page in addition, each with unique variations on the same style. We could potentially accomplish this by creating a new list called Pages, with blog and news as values, which is achieved by adding brackets and then listing each value in a comma-separated list. Because we're using strings here, we're also going to surround each element with quotation marks, but if you were using something like a number, this may not be necessary. We can now create a new style for each of these new elements, which we can do with a loop. We'll talk about loops in more detail in a moment, but for now we can just add at each $page in $pages and then open and close curly braces, and we'll add this to the blog.scss file. Don't worry about separating out context right now, we're just doing this for demonstration purposes. Inside of the curly braces we're going to type dot hash open curly brace $page, close curly brace, and then an open and close curly brace again. Notice that this variable has a hash and then curly braces either end of it. That's important because it tells Sass that we're going to create a new style. We're not going to leave this style blank however, and so we can add in a simple style just to make sure that the style shows up in our native CSS file. So let's take a look at the native CSS file to see how we're progressing. As you can see, our new styles have been created as you would expect. If we want to finish our objective of having similar styles for different types of containers, we could even extend the main container. Just thinking of the bigger picture as well, this could also be a great place to use conditional statements too, so some pages within a list could have some additional formatting applied to them. Another data type that we've mentioned was maps, which could be compared to associative arrays. If you've never used anything like this before, then the idea is almost identical to lists, except that all of the values that you assign have actual names attached to them, instead of just being values. A good example of this could be colours. Instead of maybe having hundreds of different colour variables on your style sheets, you could create a single generic colour variable, which will store a map of all of the different colours that you're going to use. To do this, you would basically do the exact same thing as you've done when creating a list earlier, except that now we're going to name each value. So here we can see we've created a colour variable, and then within the list we've created an index called primary, which we have assigned the colour red to. We could then create a second variable called secondary, which we will assign white to. As you can see, the format is identical to lists except that we add the name in, and the name itself doesn't have a dollar sign, which is important to remember because all other variables do have a dollar sign. I would normally spread this out over multiple lines too, and because we're using SCSS in this example, the white space doesn't matter, but if you're using Sass instead, you won't be able to do this, so keep that in mind. So how do you access the values within the map? Well, that's easy. You just type map-get open brackets the name of the map, so in our case it is colours, and then the value that you want to return. So we want to return the primary colour in this instance, so we'll type primary, again without any dollar sign, and this time without any quotation marks. And this is because we're not looking for a string called primary, we're looking for a value called primary, so quotation marks are not needed. If we jump back across to our native CSS file, we can now see the colour has correctly been pulled from the map and placed where you would expect it. There are plenty of other things that you could use maps for, and if you think of them as a collection of related values, you may be able to think of some use cases yourself. The final thing that we're going to talk about in this video and this series is loops. Within Sass, we have access to three different types of loops, for, each, and while. And they're all used for different scenarios, as they are in other programming languages. For loops repeat the contents of the curly braces a specific number of times, and you know exactly how many times before the loop starts. By you, I don't specifically mean you the person, but something in the code. A variable, for example, holds a number which represents the number of times the code should be processed. Each loop repeats once for every index within a map or a list, and where you also need to use the values contained within the map or list within the loop. So for example, we wanted to retrieve the values contained within the pages variable earlier, which we used within the loop to create new styles. While loops repeat while the condition is true, so it's almost like a for loop combined with an if statement. As soon as the condition has been met, the loop ends. You should be particularly careful when using while loops, because it's easy to create an infinite loop, that is, a loop where the condition can never be met, and so the loop will never end. So how do we actually write each of these styles of loop? For loops are very simple. At for, $i, from 1 through 4, and then curly braces. And we have used $i, or the iterator, to represent how many times the loop has progressed. The first time the loop is run, in this example, it will be 1, then 2, then 3, and then 4. You can use this variable within your style too, just like any other variable. As we saw earlier, we can also use the each loop in a very similar manner, when we typed at each colour in colours, and then curly braces. The second variable in this case must be for a list or a map, and every time the loop progresses, it cycles through each value in the list or the map. If you're using a map and you want to access both the element's name and its value, you can adjust each command to have two variables, so it could change to something like at each name value in map name. And again, you can use both of these variables within your style if you want to. Finally, we have the while loop. This is slightly different and is written as at while and then the condition. So for example, $i is less than 10. This isn't very far from the other loops just yet, but it's important to note that the value of the variable $i in this case is set before the while loop. And so we can add in $i is equal to 5 above the loop. At the moment, this will create an infinite loop, because the value of $i currently never changes, and so it's important that you always add in something to change the value of the variable so that you can eventually escape the loop. You can do this in any number of ways. In this case, because we're using numbers as our condition, we can simply increase the value of $i within the loop by adding $i is assigned to $i plus 1. But you don't have to use numbers, you can use any condition you can think of. What do you think of this video? Has it been helpful? Have you learned something new? Let me know in the comments, hit that subscribe button, and check out some of these other videos.